brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, there is one word that seems to be leaving the English language in usage. Used to be more regularly used. It's the word sorry. When I was growing up in Africa as a child, there were two words that I learned in the Chewa language. The first was pepani, and the other one was zikomo. Pepani ndi zikomo. Pepani means I'm sorry. Zikomo, thank you. Where do those words go? They've gone. They've disappeared. They're still in the dictionary. But do you hear them very much anymore? Is it regular usage time for pepani ndi zikomo? And the answer is no. Children will come and take something as though it's expected. Why should I say thank you for something that I expect? And definitely, why should I say sorry? Because that's going to make me feel bad because I did something wrong. And I don't want to feel bad. So I'm not going to say I'm sorry because that's an admission of guilt. That means I'm less than perfect. And we've missed, we have lost those, we are losing those words. They should be part and parcel of our Christian culture. We should, as Christians, be the people who are saying thank you and I'm sorry all of the time. Not only to our God, but also to each other. The fact that we have lost the usage of these terms is very troublesome. Very, very troublesome. How could we have lost that? This is basic. This is bottom basic. Raising of children and being a member of society. Basic level. This is what and how we should walk as children of God. And the words before us this morning, I didn't take one single text because I read the Old Testament text, the first reading, and then I read the second lesson. I said, well, that was a good one too. And then I read the gospel, and Jesus made some good points here. So I said, well, which one should I preach on? So I decided I'm going to preach on all three of them. The first one is acknowledge your sin. Say, pepani, I'm sorry. So I'm going to ask you, pepani, pepani. I would like you to say pepani. Pepani. I'll say one, two, three. One more time. One, two, three. Now I thank you for saying pepani. Let us also be as good as saying I'm sorry. Look at the text. Do not be idolaters as some of them were, as it is written, the people sat down to eat and drink and got up to indulge in revelry. Does that occur here? Do people in this day and age, let alone in Grenada, sit down, eat and drink, and get up and indulge in revelry? Anyone? Yes? No? Or I'll teach you some more Chewa. Inde means yes. I means no. Is this something that happens here? You better believe it does. We should not commit sexual immorality. Does it occur? Inde. Better believe it does. And is it something like, oh, this is bad, so we should stop? It's kind of like the coronavirus. Oh, the coronavirus is so bad. Lock everyone down and do this and protect and put a mask on and get yourself jabbed and do this and do that. Oh, but sexual immorality, no problem. Wow. As some of them did, and in one day, 23,000 of them died. Maybe that would wake us up. Because certainly a few people dying of coronavirus, and there were more than a few, woke people up, didn't it? Does it take us that much to wake us up? Whoa. We should not test Christ as some of them did and were killed by snakes. And do not grumble as some of them did and were killed by the destroying angel. Oh, my heavens. Any grumbling? Oh. Anyone ever get vexed about anything? Yeah. I tell you, yeah. Okay. Thank you for admitting it, because I admit it too. These things happened to them as examples. And have we learned from the examples? I think we still have a lot of learning to do. And were written down as warnings for us. That's like saying, I'm driving, and I did my driver's test, and you know, did the practice, and my instructor said, if the sign says stop, you stop, don't you? Yeah. So okay, I do my driver's test, and I'm driving. I see the stop sign, it's red. It says stop, and so I decide, I'm not feeling stopping today. I think I don't want to feel stopping. I go through, and boom, I get hit. And then I say, well, why did you hit me? Why is this happening to me? Now I get all upset and my insurance, and how am I going to get to work now because my car is this? Whose fault was it? It's your fault. It's my fault. And we're blaming everyone except ourselves. Lent is a time in which we take the opportunity to look in the mirror and say, yes, God, yeah, I am sorry. Pepani. Ditudi, which means really sorry. So if you think you are standing firm, be careful that you don't fall. Acknowledge your sin. Let us acknowledge our sin. We don't mandate confession. The Lord encourages you to go to Him and ask for forgiveness and be forgiven. And then also, as we prayed in the Lord's Prayer, also forgive others. At the beginning of every worship service, we have an opportunity to confess our sins, because sometimes we're not good at doing it ourselves. So not only to acknowledge what our sin is, but then also to be sorry for that sin. The Lord said, I have indeed seen the misery of my people in Egypt. I have heard them crying out because of their slave drivers. I am concerned about their suffering. Will the Lord come to you when you are anguishing over sin? And the answer is yes. But He wants you to first of all acknowledge it and then understand how serious it is. And I think we've forgotten how serious it is because we don't have 23,000 people dying. Or because of sexual immorality, or we don't have a plague of snakes because people decided that they knew better than God. What do we have? We have a Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who willingly died and suffered agony beyond our imagination because of our choice to do it our way. Because of our motivation, our selfish motivation. Because of our decision to transgress His will and say, you know what? I know God says that this is a sin, but I'm going to choose and go ahead and do it anyway. My question to you is, do you think God has changed in His hatred of sin since the Old Testament times? And the answer to that is no. All of the times that God's children in the Old Testament were punished for their sins, all of that punishment, plus all of our stuff called sin, was placed on Jesus on the cross. God has to punish sin. He's a just and holy and righteous God. And so guess how He accomplished it? He said, I'll just die for my people. I will just suffer for my people. I will just be executed in place of my people. Wow. Someone loves us so much to do that for us. How can I not only say thank you, zikomo, but how can I not then also listen to Him? My brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, go to the Lord asking for forgiveness, because what is He going to do? He's going to forgive you. He has already paid the punishment for that on the cross of Jesus Christ, on his cross. If I tell you no, but unless you repent, you too will all perish. A repentance, some people say, is a change. So you're going this way and you do a repenting, you go 180 degrees. When you are repenting, you don't go 360 degrees, because you would just wind up doing what you were doing before. When you repent, you have this change that occurs. I was going this way, now I'm going to go in the opposite direction. There's my way, sin, or there's God's way, and they are diametrically opposed to each other. Repentance is not saying, you know what, I think going my way is not good and I want to honor God. But instead of going 180 degrees, I'm just going to go 90 and see how that works out for me. Because it's just kind of half-half. So I can feel more comfortable because I'm doing my thing and I'm doing also some of the God thing. Does God look and view that as being sorry for sin? And the answer to that is no. You're either right or you're wrong. When you go to school and they're grading your math test, and they say, so in your math test, you either get it right or you get it wrong. Does your math teacher say, but you know, I saw the concentration on the face of the student, and the face of the student showed that she was working really hard at getting the right answer. So, you know, I'm going to give maybe half a point for effort, even though the answer is wrong. Is that how it goes? You go to university and you can go through university and get a passing because you tried even though you failed. Is that how life goes? Or you go to work and they say, oh yes, we'll pay you and you can stay employed even though half the time you don't show up for work, but that's fine. You show up the other half, so we'll keep you employed. Is that how it works in life? No. You're either, as Jesus says, with me, or you're against me. And the Lord is coming to you and simply saying, understand your sin. Pepani, say you're sorry, because I am here waiting to say, you're forgiven. Believe in me and I will forgive. And not only just say I'm sorry, but also then act I am sorry. What is acting I am sorry? A man had a fig tree growing in his vineyard, and he went to look for fruit on it, but he did not find any. What is God looking from you? What is he looking for from you? Fruit. Fruit of the Spirit. Asking for forgiveness, being kind, being gentle, being respectful, forgiving as you have been forgiven. That's what repentance is. It's not just something, just not a transaction that has a beginning and an end. It's a transaction that is ongoing. It is ongoing. And so in this Lenten season, we have this opportunity to become re-engaged at what it means to be a Christian. What our Christian culture should be, regardless of the culture of the world, that part of our culture should be, yes, thank you, please. So my brothers and sisters in Jesus Christ, I ask that you take this opportunity this week to practice the please and the thank you. Please forgive me. Thank you for forgiving me. Please pass this. Thank you. Please may I have some more. Thank you. Please may I have this. Please may I help. Please may I please receive this. Please give me the opportunity to help you in this. Our life should be one of please and thank you as Christians and as children of God. Amen.